Good morning. Welcome to worship on this Communion Sunday. It's good to see you all here. Just basic announcements. This is basically showing the calendar. We still have Bible Fellowship on Wednesdays in the evening. We're going through Genesis right now. The story of Jacob, all the give and take between Jacob and Laban, that's coming right up in our Bible Fellowship. Tuesday, February the 14th, is going to be Valentine's Day and also a UMW group meeting, UMW meeting at 9:30 a.m. Also, a little further down the road, leading up to UMW Sunday on Saturday, February the 18th, the day before, Pam's Wiki is going to be presenting the Bible and human sexuality. All women of the church are invited, and any friends they might want to bring. 9:30 a.m. It begins with snacks. The study starts at 10. There'll be a noon Mexican pylon lunch followed by the conclusion of the program. And then that Sunday there, that's and also on 1:30, the church council is going to meet at 1 p.m. That's going to be 2 weeks from today, correct? Yes. It is 2 weeks from today. That'll be a meeting of the church council. We push that forward a little bit. And then this year, March 1st, the first day of March, that's a Wednesday, it's going to be Ash Wednesday. I do plan on having an Ash Wednesday service. I think traditionally we've had it around 6 p.m. in the evening, and I imagine that's when it will happen this year. I still haven't decided. Maybe we'll have it at 5:30, a little earlier. And then April 9th to 16th, that's going to be Holy Week this year. So again, I welcome you all to worship. I encourage you to prepare your hearts and minds for worship as we listen to the prelude together.
Let's all stand and sing, "Seek Ye First, the Kingdom of God."
Yeah.
Our call to worship this morning is taken from Psalm 1 to 12. Praise the Lord. Happy are those who fear the Lord, who greatly delight in his commandments.
They rise in the darkness as a light for the bright. They are righteous, merciful, and righteous.
It is well with those who deal generously and lend, who conduct their affairs with justice.
They are not afraid of evil tidings. Their hearts are firm, secure in the Lord.
They have distributed freely. They have given to the poor. Their righteousness endures forever. Their horn is exalted in honor.
The wicked sin and are angry. They gnash their teeth and melt away. The desire of the wicked comes to nothing.
Our first hymn of praise is Ask You What Great Thing I Know. We'll sing all four verses.
Time of prayer this morning, I ask if any of you have any joys or concerns that you'd like to share so that we could take them before God together in prayer.
Jared, I've got a concern. My mom, as you know, has had lots going on, but And one day this week, Thursday, I think, she was getting ready for that stuff for the day, and she, her hip that she's had a problem with popped out of joint. And that was about noon. They thought they were going to have to do surgery, but they finally got it popped back in place about 7 o'clock that evening. She goes to the doctor tomorrow to find out if she is going to have surgery on that hip. She really is, she's scared because so much has been going on, and she's just really scared if she has to have surgery, it's going to go bad. So just pray for her that for no surgery. And she started her chemo Tuesday, and so pray for radiation. Started the radiation Tuesday, so she pray that all the radiation goes well and everything, all the cancer's gone.
Are there other joys or concerns this morning?
Sharon Hawley had the heart attack.
Sharon Hawley.
Two heart attacks. Please lift up Barbara Brashears. Terry Whiteley is at MD Anderson, and Ursilia Doss had her fourth round of chemo.
You always Remy and her family.
Was it just Terry Whiteley, or did you throw another name in there?
Ursilia Doss.
Ursilia?
Yeah, her cancer came back. She's going through chemo again.
And it was, did you say Goth?
Doss.
Dot.
Doss.
D-O-S-S.
Doss. Ursilia Doss. Are there other joys or concerns this morning? Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Almighty God, you created the heavens and the earth to show your glory. You created us to be bearers of your spirit to the world. We ask this morning that you would grant us peace, joy, and love that we might accomplish that. We come before you as any would come before a caring parent to share our needs, our concerns with you. There are many who are struggling with their health. We ask your healing hand upon all. We lift up before you Ursilia Doss. We ask that you would support her spirit as she faces this returning threat of cancer. We ask that you would be with Terry Whiteley as she is at MD Anderson undergoing further treatment. We ask that you would help Barbara Brashear in her recovery, that you would support and sustain her family members who are seeing what she is going through and who earnestly desire to show their love for her as well as yours. We pray for Sharon Hawley, that you would grant wisdom to her doctors, that they could sort out her condition and find a truly effective treatment. We pray also this morning for Lana Vinsel, that her radiation treatment would go smoothly, yes, but especially that when her hip is examined, it might be found that she has no need of surgery. She has faced many hurdles in her health, and our heart cannot but break at the thought of another. We ask that you would spare her and bring her good news in that report. We thank you, God, for the high calling in Christ Jesus we have, for the privilege we have of embodying peace, joy, and love, and mercy to the world. We gladly receive the responsibility to be salt and light, understanding that we may often fall short of that high calling in Christ. We ask that you would help us to run our race with perseverance, that you would stir up within us such joy in serving you and others, such compassion for one another and for our neighbor, for whomever is wounded and weighed down, that we just can't keep our mouths shut and our hands at our sides, living life as usual. Give us a glimpse of the world through your eyes and inspire us with a new vision of what it means to bear witness to your kingdom, to salt this world with peace, and to spread upon it the light of the good news of Jesus Christ, who showed us how to live and who taught us how to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Good morning. The epistle reading this morning is from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 26 through chapter 2, verse 12. "Consider your own call, brothers and sisters. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were noble of birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce to nothing things that are, so that one might boast in the presence of God. He is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. In order that, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. When I came to you, brothers and sisters, I did not come proclaiming the mystery of God to you in lofty words or wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I came to you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. My speech and my proclamation were not with plausible words of wisdom, but with a demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might rest not on human wisdom, but on the power of God. Yet among the mature we do speak wisdom, though it is not a wisdom of this age, or of the rulers of this age, who are doomed to perish. But we speak God's wisdom, secret and hidden, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love him. These things God has revealed to us through the Spirit. For the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For what human being knows what is truly human except the human spirit that is within? So also no one comprehends what is truly God's except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit that is from God, so that we may understand the gifts bestowed upon us by God."
Our hymn of preparation is "Shine, Jesus, Shine." If you want to stand with me, we'll sing all three verses of this.
Nations.
5:13-16, and perhaps a little bit easier to understand than the first reading. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under a bushel basket, but on the lampstand. And it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. That's the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now, if you'll pray with me. Father, this morning we were reminded that we can come boldly to the throne and that we can speak boldly wherever you are working, so that others may come to know the truth of the gospel, that is indeed the good news, and it is salvation to those who come to you. And Lord, I learned something yesterday also about how as a church we need to be bold and speak the truth. And I thank you that our pastor does that, Father. And that he explains to us, shows us the word, teaches us, always based on the word. And Father, we know that leads to salvation. So again, be with him this morning, Father. And again, be with us as we listen. And Father, make us a church that affects our community. And sometimes we don't know what to ask for, just as the disciples didn't. But when they saw God working and in control, and that Jesus had come and done exactly what God had said, they became bold. So let us become bold too. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, the gospel passage certainly is shorter than Paul's. But is it really easier to understand? We hear it all the time, salt of the earth, light of the world. Well, what is salt? One thing we know it was is, of course, it's a preservative. You put it on meat to stop it from rotting. Salt resists corruption. And yes, that's the reason why they would use it sometimes in treaties to indicate that they wanted the treaty to last and not fall apart because of the just human rottenness of the participants. In a way, the salt of the earth implies that the earth is dead. And certainly, death is Earth's home. We don't hear it happening in heaven or any other realm. And the Earth does have a tendency to rot rather than to automatically flourish. We know that's certainly true with our houses. It's true with ourselves. Just look at the effect gravity has on us year by year. However careful we are to try to fight against it, eventually it's going to win. And we do hear people talk a lot about the death rate from heart disease, cancer, and how to avoid these things, how to live healthier and longer, but the fact remains that death rate never changes. It's one per person. Now, light does something, too, that's interesting. It can reveal imperfections. You know, if a photographer who wants to get, if he wants to get paid, he might use soft light and soft focus. And I still believe that's one of the reasons why Christians are occasionally persecuted. Light will also not just reveal beauty, it's going to reveal ugliness. But there's something else about that image of a city set on a hill that we kind of miss. It's not the fact, because Jesus is talking about light, it's not the fact that it's sitting up on a hill and you can't miss it. It's the fact that it has light coming out of it at night, and it's on a hill, you can't hide it. But that means then that the world is in darkness. Still, I mean, these are encouraging words to hear that I'm the salt of the earth, or at least I can be, that I'm the light of the world. But still, we shouldn't miss the context. The earth is full of corruption. We all have a tendency toward that. Everything tends to fall apart over time. And yes, the world is full of darkness. In that sense, the city on the hill, I think it's a image for the church, the people of God. The city on the hill does not replace the sun. No people, no nation, no set of laws or institutions will ever be the sun. No one can hope to replace it. Last week, I ended with sort of a throwaway illustration I didn't have time to develop. It was getting late. Typhoid Mary. I was talking about the people who wanted to go straight past all the early Beatitudes and be peacemakers. They didn't understand their essential emptiness. They didn't have that poverty of spirit. They didn't mourn over their own blindness and corruption and the violence of the world. You know, they didn't really submit to God and hunger and thirst for God's righteousness. They didn't allow their hearts to be purified by a knowledge of God's love. Now, they didn't want to do any of that because they had the answers and they wanted to go straight to peacemaking. And they thought the answers lay in all the things that they had figured out. The wisdom of the world, that's what Paul is alluding to in that passage in Corinthians. He's saying that's not the answer. But that's what the people of the world, the wise and the powerful of the world, want to give us, their answers. They assure us that this is how we can actually be salt, bring peace to the world, and be light. We can just need to educate people, give them the right ideas, and we could have a much better world. So what I did is I went and I looked for an example of a typhoid Mary who was out there not symptomatic, in other words, kept his own life pretty much together, lived a prosperous, happy life, but he was spreading ideas that really could only end in disaster. And I picked H.G. Wells. I loved the man's stories, but I found that I only liked the movies based on his fantastic science fiction stories. If I ever read the books, I found I couldn't get through them. And I think part of the reason was this worldview that was underlying it. Now, not a humble man, in 1922, Mr. Wells wrote A Short History of the World. And at its conclusion, this is 1922, they've recovered from World War I, it looks like the League of Nations is going to get going, and he writes this: "As yet, we are hardly in the earliest dawn of human greatness. But in the beauty of flower and sunset, in the happy and perfect movement of young animals, and in the delight of 10,000 various landscapes, we have some intimations of what life can do for us." I love that. He's looking at the glory of God and nature and looking at it as how can we get it to do something for us. "And in some few works of plastic and pictorial art, paintings, in some great music, in a few noble buildings and happy gardens, we have an intimation, a hint, of what the human will can do with material possibilities. Can we doubt that presently our race will more than realize our boldest imaginations, that it will achieve unity and peace? that it will live in a world made more splendid and lovely than any palace or garden that we know, going on from strength to strength in an ever-widening circle of adventure and achievement. What mankind has done, the little triumphs of his present state, in all this history we have told in all the book before, form but the prelude to the things that man has got to do. Wow. That was his optimism, his certainty that we just had it all figured out. 20 years later, in the midst of World War II, and toward the end of it, he's writing this. A series of events has forced upon the intelligent observer the realization that the human story has already come to an end, and that Homo sapiens, as he has been pleased to call himself, is in his present form played out. The stars in their courses have turned against him, and he has to give place to some other animal better adapted to face the fate that closes in more and more swiftly upon mankind. Wow. But of course, that's where it was always going to end up, wasn't it? He thought that if you just looked at our own capacity, that we could adapt to our circumstances. His basic philosophy was evolution, based on an undergraduate education in the 1890s. And, you know, and it was also his hope, but eventually, you know, the truth just had to come out. And in his one of his later books, At the Mind at the End of Its Tether, he writes this: the world is at the end of its tether. The end of everything we call life is close at hand and cannot be evaded. Our universe is not merely bankrupt, there remains no dividend at all. It has not simply liquidated, it is going clean out of existence, leaving not a rack behind. The attempt to trace a pattern of any sort is absolutely futile. For decades, H.G. Wells was too busy evangelizing his message of one world government and a sort of singular intellectual vision that he called a world brain governing it all. He was too busy with all that to see the cracks in his cistern that it could hold no water, that death reigns in the universe, not just in our lives, but even over the planets and the stars. He could distract himself for a little while, but eventually he had to see it. Well, why do we care about what H.G. Wells said so long ago? One is it's easier to see errors when they're not our errors. And we all have shreds of such ideas lurking in our lives. We might call ourselves practical and grounded by focusing on the here and now, what we can actually get done, as though there was really hope in the things that we focus on day to day. We ground our hope in this world without any reference necessarily to what Christ hopes for in us, not just now, but also in the age to come. But all those plans that are strictly human wisdom that don't have any reference to God, they're coming to nothing. H.G. Wells was particularly upset about religion, and especially Christianity, but I think most of all he really thought as most ridiculous the idea of the incarnation, that he might be confronted with God in the flesh. And I don't think it's a coincidence either that Richard Dawkins, who wrote, I think he wrote The God Delusion, Christopher Hitchens, another evangelical atheist, they both share that same culture of H.G. Wells, that vision that we just need to get the wisdom right, force everybody to think the same way, get one world government, and that'll be the end of war and disease. But you see, eventually the truth will out, and I worry that all such people will come to that point that the powerful always do. One of my favorite quotes is of Caligula. I think, like, I would have a favorite quote from such a guy, but he was frustrated that he couldn't fix everything and get what he wanted, and he said this telling thing: would that the people of Rome had but one neck, I would slit it. That tyrannical impulse, as though, no, it's really, I want everybody to think the same way because I want to do them good. What lays behind it is a tyrannical impulse of the human will to have its own way. It's the same story as it was in the garden, and it comes to a very bad end. This is in all of us. Sometimes we see it writ large in the figures of history, but there's elements of it in all of us. And the second reason why we might want to care about those great figures in the past and why I bring them up is because sometimes we look at all the big currents of history and we say, what does my life matter? But you see, it's the world that's trained us to think that history happens through great people and great events. History always happens one person at a time. That doesn't change. Everyone gets to be one person, no more, no less. And in this struggle to be salt and light that we have as Christians, I'm reminded of a quote that Alexander Solzhenitsyn had in one of his books, where he lamented that if only there were evil people somewhere insidiously committing evil deeds, and it was necessary only to separate them from the rest of us and destroy them. That's the rational, the logical, the worldly man. But, he wrote, the line dividing good and evil cuts through the heart of every human being, and who is willing to destroy a piece of his own heart? There are ways of looking at things, of doing things, of thinking of ourselves we don't want to let go, because part of those roads that lead to hell are some of our most cherished ideas. And I wonder if sometimes it's not as though Christ arrives in our light, our life with the light. And he maybe lights our lamp, and he invites us to follow him out of this dark cave in which we're lost. But some will not follow him out. They stay behind with their own little pale lamps. They look around at this dark cave, and they find out, hey, the wall actually sparkles in the light. It's quite pretty. They sweep the cave. They find water, mushrooms to eat. Oh, it's so promising. Maybe we can put up curtains until the flame begins to flicker. The fire fades. The walls turn to ashen gray, and the darkness returns. Jesus warns us about this. He's a realist. He's not giving us some fantastical pie-in-the-sky message. He's giving us a real message about the real world. And so he leaves us with the parable of the wise and the foolish bridesmaids, the ones who just show up, okay, I've got a lamp, whatever. But there's others who prepared ahead of time, who have the oil, and when the bridegroom arrives, they go in with him. The others, they don't have enough oil. They're off trying to find it. Basically, when the moment comes, when Christ calls out to us and says, I have something for you to do right now. I want you to go here. I want you to do that, this. I want you to whatever, that motion of God in our heart, and we feel that we're on the Lord's business, but we have no oil. We haven't been praying. We haven't been working on our faith. We've been taking it for granted. We've been praying that we can get our debts paid, that pain would go away, that so-and-so, we just have different kind of, we're worried about our own business. And when the Lord comes and says, I have something for you to do, we just don't have enough oil. Our lamps would go out. At the end of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus gives the same message. He says, whoever listens to my words and does them, I liken them to the wise person who built, you know, their home on the rocks. But the person who doesn't listen and doesn't do these things is like someone who built on the sand. And when the storm came, it was swept away. Isn't that when we find out if we really have faith? That's when I found out that I didn't know God as well as I thought I did, is when something bad happened, a dream of mine was taken away, and I was crushed. It was as though the world had been destroyed. God hadn't gone anywhere. Christ had not changed. God still loved me, but I had such a time recovering from those blows that I had in my youth. I realized, wow, I don't really love God. I use God. My life is built on sand in my own dreams. I wasn't yet fit to be salt and light. Fortunately, Christians don't look at the ideal like optimists, as though the world is going to be perfect. All we have to do is just let everything fall into place. Such ideal optimists, they fall steadily into confused denial as the nature of the world becomes clear when they see that everything doesn't always work out to make us happy. And on the other hand, we're not pessimists in the face of the world's corruption in darkness, because we're not looking at the world. We look at Jesus Christ, who is in fact that ideal made real. In John 12:35, Jesus says to his disciples, the light is with you a little longer. Walk while you have the light, so the darkness may not overtake you. If you walk in the darkness, you do not know where you are going. And that's how it is when we come into dark times and we don't have that oil in our lamps. We didn't expect this to happen. And we begin to lose sight of God in our lives. Now, salt, how do we function as salt? Well, as in its preservative capacity, if you're in a group and you can inoculate the group against gossip, you just don't have an ear for it. If they start talking about, well, so-and-so's having trouble paying off this debt, and isn't that sad? If you start piping up and saying, wow, what can we do to help them? The real vicious gossips who are just talking to get other people down are not going to say that in your presence anymore. When they start talking about other people's troubles, you're going to drag them into helping them. That's not what they wanted. They just wanted to sort of gleefully be glad that they didn't have the problems of those other people. And I remember probably a dramatic idea of somebody, example of somebody who was salt. I was walking around campus in my college days, and a group of about six guys decided to surround me and play the little push game, and it was getting worse and worse, and I was thinking, oh great, I think they're about to beat me up. And yet one in the group said, no, he's not a bad guy, leave him alone. And it stopped. That was salt. It kept the corruption from growing away, and I was the benefit that day just because there was an element of God's grace in one person's life that said, this isn't the way this should go. He kept his friends from doing an evil to me. And light also has, how are we light? One way in which we can be light, of course, is to take away the gray. That's one of the reasons why in revealing the world's ugliness by contrast, we can be persecution. But light also shows another people another way to go. And by that word of kindness, that word of excuse, that word of mercy that guy showed to his friends, he indicated that there was another way to go than to feel good about themselves by injuring me. But light can also reveal great beauty, and it reveals it most sharply in times of darkness. One of the classic examples that is cited is the Amish community that had their schoolhouse shot up, their children shot by a maniac. And the first place they went was to the family of the man who had done it, to see if they could help them, to show them mercy. And the world was astonished. And they said, you mean we could react that way too? Salt, back to salt. It's not just a preservative, it's also the original seasoning. Salt brings out the flavor in things. And I think we can be salt in that way too. We can show people how to have joy in their life without having to distract themselves with entertainments, without having to have just thrills of the flesh, the roller coasters or exciting movies. We can hopefully show them what the joy of fellowship looks like. So that we should never be, in that sense, Debbie Downers. That was a character from Saturday Night Live that I remembered. It seemed to be her habit whenever she was eating with people to carefully go through and say, oh, you're eating that, that's going to give you cancer, that's going to give you heart disease, and I wouldn't eat that. That's not really what Christians are called to do. And we're not meant to be wet blankets. We're meant to show people the real joy of life, that when we live in gratitude to God and we enjoy the things of the earth, in giving thanks to God, life can be great. I mean, it can be amazing. One of the things that always gets to me, and I guess when I'm thinking about food, is if you go out and you look at nature, you see grass growing. Well, we found out we could turn that into wheat and make bread out of it. We can make pasta out of it. We can make a million different things out of it. We found other strange plants that we turned into spices. If you look at the raw ingredients, say if you just take rice, some roots, and a chicken going around stinking and shedding feathers, somebody can turn that into pad thai. With our creativity, we can really get a lot of joy out of the simple pleasures of life. And God wanted for us to do that, to discover the wonderful possibilities of the creation, not so that we could enjoy ourselves, but so that we could realize how wonderful and glorious and gracious and generous our God is. And just as salt is the original seasoning, light is the original bleach. That's, you know, if you think about Jesus' white and bright clothes at the Transfiguration, the two are connected there. There's this glorious light, and his clothes were as white as they possibly could be. Light is the ultimate in stain removers. And the example that I was trying to think of one that I came up with was not long ago I was having a conversation with the district superintendent, and I'm telling here on myself, nothing about him. But we were just having a conversation about the church and what was going on, and I found myself feeling kind of anxious. I couldn't listen to him, and I was getting defensive on some points. And then it was out of proportion to the circumstance, and I realized, oh, yeah, I remember this. And I talked with him about it. When I was growing up, whenever something happened that I really needed my dad to have a heart-to-heart with me, I don't think he had a dad like that either. His dad was a workaholic. So what he did is he took me into his office. He put me in the guest chair. He looked very official and authoritative, and I couldn't have felt more alone during those conversations. And so whenever I catch somebody trying to be pastoral or fatherly to me, sitting behind a desk in that setting, that old junk comes up. And I realized that, and I talked about it, and we talked about it, and it didn't wreck the conversation. I got past it. But you see, light had been shined in. Both of us were kind of looking at that dynamic. It was interesting, and it was related to what we were talking about, but I thought, wow, the light had sort of taken away an ancient stain. It had bleached out something, and it had given me power to be a more genuine and sincere person. And it makes me think of 1 John 1:7. If we walk in the light, as he, Christ, himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin. It's that essential ability to confront the truth, to understand our old hurts, the things that are driving us, the old desires and the disappointments, and to get clear about them so that we can walk in a way that is more truer to the way that we know Christ wants us to walk, in peace and in love with one another. But we tend to be very private and we shut down. Well, it occurs to me that if we can't do that among fellow Christians sometimes, if we can't even deal with those hot buttons here, and we think we're going to get that clarity among those who know how to press them best, i.e. our family, we're kidding ourselves. It'll just keep happening over and over and over again. In Romans 13:11, Paul writes, knowing the time, that it is high time to awake out of sleep. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk honestly as in the day. That city on the hill that cannot be hid is a place where there is light, where people can see what they're doing. They can see and understand themselves and one another and walk the way God wanted them to walk. In our reading from Corinthians, Paul points out that God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise, what is weak to shame the strong. But he says, among the mature, we do speak wisdom, though it's not a wisdom of this age or of the rulers of the age who are doomed to perish. But we who have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit that is from God, we may understand the gifts bestowed on us by God. The wisdom that we receive is something that only comes through the Spirit. That's pretty much what Paul is saying. And that the real wisdom of life that we need to know shouldn't make sense to somebody who doesn't know God. And one of the ways that we receive of that Spirit is, of course, communion. Some people call it a mystery, but this week I've kind of begun to think of it as not a mystery in the sense of something vague or something far away or something almost woo, that might be what a skeptic would say. But mysterious in the sense of airplanes were mysterious when I was a little kid. I had no idea then how you got a plane up in the air. All I knew is that you got on board and that an hour later, 2 hours later, you got out of the airplane and the world had changed. And I had no clue how that had happened. And I think of the grace that comes to us through the mystery of communion is like that. That in this act of obedience, we receive the grace that Christ intended for us. to purify us from our sins, to empower us to walk the way he wanted us to walk, to live the lives he wanted to. We don't have to understand it. We don't have to figure it out. But we do have to obey it. We have to get on the airplane. And here, as one people of God, if we are one with Christ and one with each other, we can say on his authority, we can say through his power that we are the salt of the earth, we are the light of the world. We don't have to figure it out. We just have to follow him and trust him to make it happen and not kid ourselves if we're still clinging on to the old ways of doing things. In our heart of hearts, if we are, God will show it to us. He will reveal it to us if we ask him. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for the gift of wisdom that you give us through Jesus Christ, the gift that you give us by your Spirit and by your grace to grow in our knowledge and love of you and in our understanding, in our appreciation and our love for one another. We ask that you would purify our hearts this morning, that you would open our eyes to your glory, that we might partake of your table worthily and by faith, and so receive the full blessing you intend for us, so that through us, others might also be blessed. For this is your will for us in Jesus Christ. Amen. At this time, I invite the ushers to come forward and prepare to receive God's tithe and our offering. Okay. Let us pray. Most merciful God, you've called us to flavor your world with peace, to be like a city upon a hill, lit up with light for a world that is in darkness. Help us live in your light so that we may see where we're going, understand what we're doing, and accomplish the good works you have prepared for us to do. Bless these offerings, use them, and employ us to help others come to know you as God Almighty, and Christ as Lord and Savior. May your Holy Spirit fill us and overflow from us till every vessel, small and great, is full. We ask this in the name of Jesus, who is love and light and life to the world. Amen. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. You'll find the liturgy for the Great Thanksgiving and the responses on page 13 and 14 of the United Methodist Hymnal. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. And the cup for which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. The Lord has anointed, the table is prepared. You may come forward and receive.
Our hymn of dedication is "This Little Light of Mine." If you stand with me, we'll sing the first two verses, and after the benediction, we'll sing the third verse as our response.
Is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. For you and for me to be who we truly are, shine for the world and for one another, and all of us with unveiled faces will be seeing the glory of the Lord as though reflected in a mirror, and we will be transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord the Spirit. Therefore, since it is by God's mercy that we are engaged in this ministry, in this church, we do not lose heart. Amen.
All through the night, I'm gonna let it shine.